Yeah, hi everyone, welcome to my second physics lecture on YouTube. Today we will continue with the topic kinematics, exactly where we stopped last time. So in the last video, as you remember, we have discussed the formula V is equal to delta S over delta T. Now we choose the initial conditions in a way that S1 is equal to 0 and T1 is equal to 0. So this means that we can omit these two Greek delta symbols that we have introduced last time here and shorten this a little bit to write only V is equal to S over T. Now we want to solve this formula for the distance and time depending on which parameters are given and which have to be calculated. So if, for example, V and T are given, the equation has to solve for the distance S by multiplying this equation with T. The resulting formula is shown then here, and this says basically S is equal to V times T. In case V and S are given, one has to solve it for T as shown here, and this says T is equal to S over V. However, it is always beneficial in physics to understand the concept instead of memorizing things just blindly. Therefore, instead of learning all these three formulas by heart, I would always recommend to memorize maybe only the easiest one, which is S is equal to V times T, and then remember how to solve it in order to obtain the parameter that you want to calculate. Now, in the next step, I want to generalize the previously made statements about the terms distance and velocity. Until now, we always assumed that all objects that we describe are only moving along one axis, which is basically describing a motion only in one dimension. As long as the object travels along a straight line, we learned that we can always shift and rotate the coordinate system of the observer in a way that the motion of this object can be only described in one axis, and then in this case only absolute values can be used. Now we will try to understand how to describe the motion of an object in a two or even in a three-dimensional world. So we generalize these quantities a little bit more. So let's take a look at this Cartesian coordinate system, two-dimensional coordinate system, which is represented by the x-axis and the y-axis. In this system, we just choose an arbitrary start point, let's call it S1, and an arbitrary end point, let's call it S2. And the vector that corresponds to S1 is called R1, just to memorize it a little bit easier. The one for S2 is called R2. And the components of R1 is given here as x1 and y1, whereas the components of R2 are named x1 and y1. With this information, we can calculate then the distance vector, delta r, this is shown here, as R2 minus R1. In the same way, we have defined the distance with absolute values. We can also just substitute these values with vectors. So the components of delta r are shown here, are therefore named as delta x and delta y, and delta x is defined as x2 minus x1, and delta y is defined as y2 minus y1. So in this case, the absolute value delta s is given according to the Pythagorean theorem as the square root of delta x plus delta x square plus delta y square. And finally, the square root of delta x square plus delta y square. If we want to compute the absolute value of the velocity, then we can just simply divide delta s by delta t. In order to calculate the velocity, the vector quantity velocity, we can also directly divide the distance vector delta r by delta t. So in this case, the velocity by itself becomes a vector, v, and can be written as v equal to delta r over delta t. Dividing a vector by a constant means that all the components of this vector have to be divided by this component. So here it will be therefore delta x over delta t and delta y over delta t. If we want to describe the motion in a three-dimensional world, it's very simple. We can just add one additional axis, which means we have to add one component to every vector. So in case of R1, we get another component Z1. In case of R2, we get another component Z2. In case of delta R, we will get delta Z. And then we can just simply divide it by delta T in order to get the vectorial quantity velocity. Now I would like to mention something else very important, the difference between the word speed and velocity. So I have used both words several times. So while velocity is used when we talk about the vectorial quantity, including a direction and also magnitude, the word or the term speed refers always only to the absolute value. So sometimes it is very difficult to really differentiate between these two words. I'm also mixing these two definitions sometimes up, but I try, or I promise that in the future, in order to try to avoid confusion, I will always use the right definition. Okay, the main reason why I emphasize on calculating with vectors or doing vector calculations of distances and velocities, for example, is because of the so-called superposition principle. The name sounds initially a little bit complicated, but we will see that it is indeed very easy to understand. First, we have to know what a vector is, and this I have explained briefly before. A vector is basically a physical quantity that contains a magnitude, an absolute value, basically, and a direction. So, example for these vectorial quantities are, for example, the distance, the speed, or the terms that we will learn later, acceleration and force. But there are also quantities that do not have a direction, only a number, and this is, for example, temperature and also energy. Both we will learn, or the meaning of both we will learn a little bit later. So the superposition principle that I want to introduce now basically says that the physical quantity, or that physical quantities can interfere without influencing each other. The definition is shown here. So in other words, one can say the net response of a system is equal to the sum of all individual components. So this sounds a little bit confusing, maybe in the beginning, but we will soon understand what it really means. So in case of velocities, for example, the superposition principle just says that two velocity vectors of an object can always be added up to a resulting velocity. If, for instance, as you can see here, an object travels with the velocity v1 into x direction and the velocity v2 into a y direction, then the resulting vector v res, this is given here, is just the vector sum of v1 and v2. I want to explain the superposition principle a little bit deeper by performing an experiment with a ball and a moving plate. Again, this is a ray traced animation of a real experiment. So first, as we can see here, the ball rolls over a plate that does not move. So the ball rolls from a defined start point and reaches, after a specific time, an end point. And we should keep this end point in mind, because in the next step we want to move the plate into the direction of the ball's velocity, as you can see here, with a constant speed. So as one can see, the ball travels a much larger distance than before, because both velocities of the ball and also of the moving plate have to be added up. In this case, the speed of the ball and the speed of the plate have to be added up, because they move in the same direction. Now finally, we can also move the plate in the perpendicular direction, and we observe that the ball covers the same distance in this direction, in the direction of his movement. So this means that the movement of the plate perpendicular does not change the absolute value of the direction of the original velocity, and this matches also with our daily life experience. So the superposition principle is not only used in kinematics, but it plays an important role in all physics disciplines, and we will mention this principle in the future again and again. Therefore, it is very important that you memorize it and you try to understand it as good as possible. So now I want to explain this principle a little bit deeper with the help of an example as shown here of two people. Yeah, let's call them Anna and Bob. So both want to move up from the first floor of a building to the second floor. Bob decides just to use simply the stairs, while Anna wants to save a little bit time and travels with an escalator. So the distance that has to be covered is assumed for both to be 6 meters. And the walking speed, because Anna also additionally walks on the escalator in order to save even more time, is assumed to be 1.2 meters per second. So the escalator moves according to the German law with a speed of 0.5 meters per second. Now the question is, what is the resulting time difference between the arrival of Bob and Anna? And of course there should be a difference in the arrival because Anna moves faster. For calculating the arrival time of Bob, we simply calculate with this formula that I have shown before, t equals to s over v. And this results in 5 seconds. If we add 6 meters for the distance and 1.2 meters per second for the velocity. In case of Anna, it's a little bit more complicated because we first have to add the speed of the escalator to the walking speed of Anna, and this we can do because the velocity vectors of both are showing in the same direction. If this was not the case, the sum has to be complicated, has to be calculated a little bit more complicated, but now we can just sum up the magnitudes, and in this case it is 0.5 meter per second plus 1.2 meter per second, and this the result is 1.7 meter per second. Then using the same formula as for Bob, it turns out that the time for Anna to reach shortens to 3.5 seconds, which makes sense because Anna moves with a faster speed. Then the time difference between Bob and Anna is just given as TB minus TA, the time for Bob minus the time of Anna, and you get as a result 1.48 seconds. Therefore, Anna reaches 1.48 seconds earlier to the second floor than Bob does. And I hope this very small example helps a little bit to understand this superposition principle a little bit deeper. Next time we will calculate some more examples regarding that, and I hope that after some time you will get a feeling for this. Later, regarding forces, this will be very interesting and very important to know. So for the time being, I want to stop here. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you don't want to miss any future video, please subscribe this channel. Then we will meet again next time, very soon. I will try to publish the next video as soon as possible. Thank you very much for your attention. And always remember, physics matters.